I'm sure you've heard of quality of service or class of service before. You've probably heard that it makes your network faster, that it drops some traffic and allows others, that it removes network congestion, or that you need it for voice traffic. QoS can do a lot of good things, but there's also a lot of misunderstandings about it. To address this, we're going to have a high-level vendor-neutral look at QoS and how it works. And while we're at it, we'll clear up some of those misunderstandings. So let's start with the basics. QoS, or quality of service, is not one single technology. Instead, it's a group of technologies and techniques that work together. It becomes important when you have limited bandwidth and one of your links is full. Imagine that you have a 1 gigabit link, and then you try to send 1.1 gigabit of data down it. That's more data than the link is capable of transporting, so while most traffic will make it, some will have to be dropped. In a case like this, quality of service can be used to decide which traffic will be allowed to pass and which traffic is selected to be dropped. A simple definition then is that QoS prioritizes more important traffic over less important traffic. In times of congestion, more important traffic will be allowed to pass, while less important traffic will drop. This is not a perfect definition, but it is a good place to start from. Now, let's clear up two misconceptions around QoS that you might have heard. First, that it makes the network faster. This simply isn't true. The only way to make the network faster is to add more links, or faster links, or better equipment. The second is that QoS prevents network congestion. This is also not true. The only way to truly prevent congestion is to have so much network capacity that you will not fill it. As you know, that's a difficult goal to reach. So why do these misconceptions exist then? When your links are full of traffic, QoS helps us to manage that traffic. By managing the traffic better, QoS helps certain applications to perform better. However, the link is still full, so while QoS helps one application to perform better, it may be at the expense of another application. This traffic management that QoS performs may give the illusion of a faster network or less congestion. Let's look at an example to show what I mean by this. Here we have a main office and a branch office. They're connected by a 100 meg WAN link, which is reaching capacity. This link carries all types of traffic, including web browsing and phone calls. When the link is over capacity, some traffic needs to drop. There's no way around that. There is a limit to how much data this link can carry. So without QoS, it's first in, first served. And there's no more logic to that. We will probably find then that voice traffic and web browsing traffic are both affected. And it might even make phone calls drop out. Phone calls are usually more important, so we can configure QoS to prioritize voice traffic. In this way, the voice traffic will always pass through, while the less important traffic will be left to drop. So notice that this still drops some traffic. QoS does not magically make your links better, faster, or anything like that. Neither does it make the congestion go away, but it does allow the more important or more sensitive traffic to go through first. As we dig deeper into QoS, you will find that it's important to understand the characteristics of different traffic types. The way these are managed on the network will affect each application. Of course, we all know about bandwidth. Some traffic types like video and file transfers use a lot of bandwidth, while other traffic types use very little. But aside from bandwidth, there are three other characteristics to consider. These are loss, latency, and jitter. Loss is the easy one. This is simply where traffic does not reach its destination. There may be several places along the network where traffic can be lost. Sometimes this is intentional, such as when we have a firewall or ACL to drop traffic for security reasons. But we're more concerned with how an application will work if traffic is lost accidentally. This includes a link that is full or is down, or where something has a hardware fault. Think about how traffic loss is handled. TCP traffic needs to be acknowledged, so missing traffic will need to be resent. UDP traffic, however, will just move on with life. However, some UDP-based applications may ask for missing data to be resent anyway. If traffic needs to be resent, sometimes this results in more traffic being generated. Next, we have latency. This is the amount of time it takes a packet to travel from one endpoint to another. These endpoints may be directly connected, or there may be devices in between. A similar term, round-trip time or RTT, describes the time taken for the packet to reach the other end and for the response to come back. Latency and bandwidth are often confused. Think of it like a water pipe. The bandwidth is how wide your pipe is, which controls how much water you can fit into the pipe at one time. The latency is the length of the pipe, and that affects how long it takes for the water to travel from one end to the other. So, more bandwidth does not always mean a lower latency. Many applications are very tolerant to latency, such as ones that use HTTP. Others, particularly real-time traffic like voice and video, care quite a lot about latency. Think of streaming video, which needs a steady stream of traffic to deliver frames on time to make the video smooth. If the packets come in late, a video may have to pause while it's buffering. Bidirectional real-time traffic is the worst hit by bad latency. A video call, for example, which is a two-way stream of video. As it's real-time, we don't even have the luxury of buffering. Now, the interesting one is jitter. This is closely related to latency. While latency measures the time for a packet to travel between two endpoints, jitter measures the variance in this time. For example, imagine that we send 5 packets and they each take 10 milliseconds. In this case, there is no variance between the packets. They all take the same time. This means that the jitter is 0 milliseconds. However, if the first packet were to take 10 milliseconds, the second takes 20, the 37, the fourth is 55, and the fifth is 37 milliseconds, we now have a lot of variance between the smallest and the largest delivery times. This is jitter. Jitter is particularly destructive to real-time applications like voice and video, as they require a steady stream of data. We want packets to arrive smoothly and consistently. The more jitter, the more erratic it becomes. Now, it is normal to see some jitter, but if you're seeing a lot, then you might have a problem somewhere on the network. Perhaps a link or device is saturated, which slows down delivery on some packets. So let's consider how quality of service may help us here. The first job of QoS is to identify certain traffic and categorize it. For example, we might have a real-time category which contains voice and video traffic. We might have another category for network management, which contains routing updates. There might be a category for business critical applications and business critical websites. And finally, we may have a category for non-essential traffic, like games or in many cases, social media. Of course, this is all customizable, and it has to be. Social media may be non-essential for one business, but it may be absolutely critical for, say, a marketing company. Now that traffic has been categorized, we can handle each category differently. For example, we may reserve a portion of our bandwidth for real-time traffic, and knowing it's sensitive to jitter and loss, we might make sure that packets aren't dropped or delayed. For another type of traffic, we might use a strategy called shaping, which delays the forwarding of packets until there is available bandwidth. For other traffic types, we might consider policing. This is where we allow a certain amount of bandwidth and no more. Anything above that limit is dropped. We'll talk about shaping and policing in an upcoming video. It is critical to understand that each device makes its own QoS decisions. This means that each device along a path must have QoS configuration to be completely effective. Of course, there may be times that you only want to apply some config in one place. This might include a firewall at the edge of the network, and perhaps it limits the amount of bandwidth that's allocated to traffic from a particular source. Even though each device is independent, they can still share some information. This is done by marking packets. After we classify traffic as part of a category, the router can put a marking in the header of the packet. This is like adding a label that tells other devices which category that packet belongs to. This means that other routers in the path can just take a look at the marking and make a QoS decision based on that. Marking is a very important process, and we're going to look at that in detail in the next video. One key point that you should remember is that QoS is especially helpful when our links are congested, or to prevent them from becoming congested. If you're regularly experiencing congestion, you may need to consider upgrading your links or reviewing the traffic that you allow on them. QoS should be considered a part of the solution, not the entire solution. Do not avoid upgrading your capacity simply because you're using QoS. Something else that we need to clear up is class of service and what that means. It sounds very similar to quality of service, so the two are often confused. Quality of service is the umbrella term for the traffic management technologies that we've been talking about so far. This includes marking packets, policing, shaping, and other things. These technologies generally work at layer 3 of the OSI model, which means they focus on IP packets. Class of service, on the other hand, is a value in the Ethernet header, which means it operates at layer 2. Specifically, it's used over 802.1q trunk links, which generally means it's used on traffic between switches. The switches set priority on these frames and decide which frames to prioritize over others. Class of service is still a traffic management technology, so it can be considered one of the QoS technologies. The last thing I'd like to point out on this, to avoid confusion, is if you use Juniper routers and switches. You will find they use a term class of service when they are talking about configuring quality of service. So if you use their devices, just be aware that they say class of service and they mean the software process for configuring quality of service. I'm sure they have their reasons for this, but personally, I find this confusing. We've covered the overview of QoS and what it does for your network and what it does not do. In the next video, we're going to look at the process of classifying traffic. This is identifying traffic and marking it. The video after that will talk about taking action on this traffic. So I hope you will join me for both of those videos.